We wanted to have you come and release the investigative report to the accident that was involving Aubrey McClendon on March 2nd. What you've been given is a copy of that report. It's about 5-6 pages long. We'll go through a little bit of it. I'll kind of explain what the report says, and then I'll open it up for some questions in regards to that report. As I said before, this was investigated on March 2nd, shortly after 10 o'clock that morning on March 2nd. Our investigators found and identified Aubrey McClendon. He was positively identified through his dental records by the medical examiner several days after the accident. If you look at the report, I think the ones that are you'd be most interested in are probably page four and five. Page four is kind of going to give you a narrative of what the investigators has said happened exactly, and kind of give you some feet measurements, lists the cause of the accident, really was speed, excessive speed. I think the speed limit on that stretch of road is 50 miles per hour. I'll tell you, jumping ahead a little bit, that the point of impact, they've estimated at 78 miles per hour at the point of impact when his vehicle hit the bridge. The vehicle was traveling, Aubrey McClendon's vehicle was traveling northbound on Midwest Boulevard, north from 122nd. We have the data, the crash data retrieval box from the vehicle. It was intact, so they were able to get some information off of that. It basically shows three different things. That data box shows speed. It shows speed 5 seconds prior to the actual crash, and it showed a speed of about 88 miles per hour, 5 seconds before the crash. It shows that he went left of center, approximately 189 feet. He would start to go left of center at about 189 feet prior to that point of impact on that bridge. That'd be about 63 yards. Which gives me a better reference usually. The speed, he maintained that speed. The data retrieval box showed that he maintained that speed of approximately 88, maximum of 89, between that 189 feet of crossing the center line to the point of impact. It also shows that he tapped his brakes, touched his brakes several times at some point between that 189 feet and point of impact. Now, when I say that, and you look at your diagram, it also shows track marks on your diagram. Those track marks are not skid marks. Those track marks are what you and I would not be able to normally see or detect, but a trained investigator, traffic investigator can. So don't get confused on your diagram where it says track marks as skid marks. Basically, it's just wheel marks. At some point, though, between that time of 189 feet of crossing the center line and actually hitting the wall, he did brake several times, tapped his brakes several times. It was not, the box shows that he taps his brakes, but it's not enough to really consider breakage. It didn't really slow the vehicle down. As you can see, the vehicle maintained about 88 miles per hour through that whole episode, even when he was touching his brakes. He had a total of three wheels that eventually left the roadway as he went left before hitting impact, and then he actually completely let off the brake or didn't touch the brake about 31 feet prior to impacting the wall. So, you know, that box showed the speed. It showed he wasn't wearing his seatbelt. It shows that speed of 5 seconds out, ranging again from 88 miles per hour to the point of impact where it estimates at 78 miles per hour. Shows he wasn't wearing a seatbelt, and that's what that shows. Again, no significant skid marks, tire marks, as he went left of center. There are also marks, obviously, when he left the roadway in the soft soil, which may have had a tendency to slow the vehicle down some also. I'll open it up to questions.
Were the brakes functioning?
Yes, as far as we know, they were functioning.
Some people have alleged this might have been a suicide. Do you guys have anything that indicates that?
You know, we're not going to speculate, because you just don't know. You don't know, one, what was going through his mind at the time. You don't know what was going on in the cabin of the vehicle. So we're not going to speculate. Basically, what you're getting today are the facts. There's a lot of things that could affect those things. Anything's possible. You don't rule it out, but we can't say it is either. So right now, the investigation is continuing. This is just part of the investigation. Right now, we have investigators that are going to be talking to people that trying to put the pieces together from maybe the night before till the time this happened to find out if there would have been any reason that he may have decided to take his own life. And then all that information will be handed over to the medical examiner's office, and the medical examiner will make that final determination.
To be clear, the evidence the investigator saw, no real attempt at trying to break the vehicle before it hit the wall, right?
There was no breakage. All I can say is there's no breakage. I mean, the actual data box shows that he touched his brakes. If you touch your brakes, your taillights are going to go on. Okay, but it does not show where there was actual hard depression of the brake where it actually would have caused the vehicle to slow. And that was indicated also in the speed. The speeds itself, the box shows that they didn't change till about 31 feet prior to impact, which would have been about a half a second.
We know he was going fast 5 seconds before the crash, but is there any data that shows that he was start speeding at that point?
We don't have that. We do not have that information. We have what's off the data box. We have a witness that actually saw the crash, but really there's no information he could give as what the speed would be. He could reach those speeds. If he left 122nd, you're talking almost 3/4 of a mile before impact. So there was plenty of time to get up to that speed after leaving the intersection at 122nd. No, the data box will give you 5 seconds prior to impact.
What would it indicate if someone tapped the brake? Why would somebody do that and not brake?
Again, that's one of those questions I can't answer. You know, you just can't answer. Because we don't know what was going on in the cabin of that vehicle, you know, or what he was thinking or what was happening. The medical examiner stated preliminarily there doesn't appear to be any type of medical episode. But there's a lot of things that could happen in the cabin of a vehicle, so I'm not going to speculate on what that tapping of the brake means. It could mean a lot of different things.
Is there the tire marks start a little bit higher up in the diagram from when his car first went left of center. Do the tire marks mean anything? Why were they greeted?
What the investigators indicated on those tire marks is it's almost like, as they explained it to me, because I'm not an expert, is that when the vehicle at that speed's moving and starts moving sideways or kind of changing the lanes like that, they were able to see distinguishing tire tracks within the roadway. If you and I walked over it, we wouldn't see it. But to a trained investigator, they can see certain type of marks that would give an indication of what the path of that vehicle was. And that's what that is. Basically, those are tire marks that showed a path, no breakage, nothing like that, that showed any type of skids.
So it's just because the tires now are moving in a different direction than the marker?
That would be correct.
Is there any indications on a cell phone?
Again, we don't know what was going on in there. I know the investigators will pull all that information and look and see, try to get cell phone records and things, but at this point we just don't have that.
Any further? I don't know any exact numbers now. Nothing really has changed since 2 weeks ago, right? This is what you guys thought you would find?
Well, I mean, the details of how fast he was going, those types of things, yeah, I mean, those things have changed. You don't know those things until after you are able to pull that data and do your measurements. They do about three different types of tests to try to determine the speed, and all those tests were consistent with what the data box had recorded, you know, plus or minus a few miles per hour, but they were consistent. So, yeah, I mean, that's basically all we have. We can't tell you, you know, what the investigation, the future investigation will hold, and the information that we would actually present to the medical examiner's office, but at some point we will have that.
Does the black box give any readings or recordings on steering or turns of the steering wheel?
It does not. Other questions? Well, the investigators will try to contact family members. They'll talk to people at his work. You know, they'll talk to anybody that they feel may have spoken to him. They'll look at maybe some of his phone records, some of his cell phone records, those types of things. Try to determine who he might have talked to, or if he was talking to somebody while he was in the vehicle, those types of things. They'll just try to run all those leads down. It's the bottom line is it's just trying to get information from people that were around Mr. McClendon the night before and maybe the day of.
Is there a timeline or an estimate as to when your investigation will be complete and turned over to the medical examiner?
There is not a timeline. No, it slowed down a little bit this week just because of spring break and people are out of town and they're gone, and some of the people I need to talk to, I know they're not able to talk to this week.